I am up to date for those of you who checked the LibGuide as of 30 minutes ago. I am up to date with all of the recordings up until now. I just turned in my annual, my alpha, and counting up sessions between basically over the past year, we've had 72 ULVLC sessions since last May.
Wow.
Exciting. And I am excited to keep it going for at least a little while longer. So with that, I am going to turn things over to David. If you have any questions, Patrick, this is a question I'm going to ask of people. So be ready for me to ask you that. If you have questions for David, if you have tech issues, anything else, please feel free to put those in the chat. I'm going to be keeping an eye on the chat while David is sharing with us. And with that, I will turn things over to David Gwynn.
Hi, I'm David Gwynn. You already knew that part, but I am here today to talk about Gateway, which is our new digital collections platform, our new collaborative community-based digital collections platform. And this is a pretty picture of it. So Tiffany and I, maybe Callie, did a session several months ago about the actual migration. So I'm not going to rehash that terribly. But why did we migrate from our old digital collections platform to our new? Well, we were at the end of life with ContentDM, the software that powered it. And they were also eliminating the option of self-hosting, which meant it was going to get a lot more complicated and a lot more expensive for us to stay with ContentDM. So we decided to focus on an open source product called Islandora. Why? Well, we had a committee that looked at it, which is, of course, the best way to do everything. So, and we found that Islandora had better user interface and discovery. It ultimately was going to give us a chance to better represent our partner collections. As you know, we work with a lot of partners here in the city to present their materials online as well. And for me, the exciting part was it sort of gave us a chance to rethink our digital collections from the ground up to get sort of a redo on how things that we might have done differently over the past 10 years, knowing what we know now. So, you know, that's why we had this, well, actually multiple year long process of moving ourselves into Gateway. And again, I say the name of this site is Gateway. And I'm stressing this because I kind of want to get us, I'm hoping we can get in the habit of actually referring to it as Gateway, as the name of the website. You know, it's tempting. For years and years, we said, oh, we'll put that in ContentDM. We'll do blah, blah, blah. I'd like us to get in the habit of referring to the website by its name rather than by the software that delivers it, especially when we're talking to people outside the library, because they don't know what an Islandora or a ContentDM is. So if we say we're putting it in Gateway, we push that that's the name of our website. That's the destination that they go to. Islandora is merely the software that drives it, and it is a Canadian open source platform that may be driving several other sites for the library at some point as well. And as such, it's a little sensitive about its name, and it's also a little sensitive, and you really should not make fun of its Canadian accent because it gets a little funky about that. So understand that it's Canadian, that it will say a and oot and hoos once in a while, and just let it go. So why did we choose the name Gateway, actually, which is actually one of the first questions that came to me on the feedback form when I first shared this with everybody in the library? Well, the idea was to give it a new name to reflect the collaborative nature of our collections. We wanted the site to actually have a name, and Gateway worked on a lot of levels because, number one, it suggests a portal or an entryway to our digital collections. It also invokes the idea and the spirit of the Gate City, which is Greensboro's nickname, because a lot of our collections, in fact, the majority of our collections, are based on local history. But at the same time, it was vague enough that it wasn't really specific just to Greensboro. So it worked there as well. You see here, we have a lot of partner collections online. We work with different universities and museums within the area, also with Cone Health, and more of that coming in the next few years. So we wanted to make it more open and to show, again, that it's not just our stuff, it's a lot of people's stuff, actually, including our community collections, which we'll talk about in a minute, too. So where are we now with the migration? Well, we're pretty much done. As you can see up there, we've got 52,489 items, which is somewhere in the neighborhood of 750,000 digital files that have been migrated into Gateway. Right now, we're working on the redirect strategy because all of these items are also included in places like WorldCat, the Digital Public Library of America, et cetera. And we want to make sure that people get redirected somewhere useful when they're coming into the site. And along with that, we are also planning the end of ContentDM. I'm excited about the end of ContentDM. I'm very excited about that, but I won't go on about it because, you know, it's a relationship that's now over and is best left behind. So, yes, I think a holiday for anti-content DM day is a thing. So kudos to a lot of people who worked on this migration. First up to the Digital Projects Priorities team who authorized it in the first place. The task force who a couple of years ago decided what software we'd be moving to. And everybody in SKUA Tech Services and Aerit who worked on the nuts and bolts. I think in SKUA particularly, shout out to Beth Ann because I fear I traumatized her a lot over the years. And she did a lot of work and was very good natured about it. In Tech Services, Tiffany and Callie did a lot of work with this project and are now working on another separate project. And also people at Aerit, Donnie and Brown on the server end, and Kathy and Charlie, who a lot of the actual file prep and manipulation came down to them, and that was a pretty monumental task as well. As well as Wilson Miracle, who many of you may remember, who actually temped on this back in the before times, getting stuff ready as well. Also, I'd like to thank Mom and Dad and the Academy. So going forward, there are a few things that as we migrate are not going to be in Gateway. The North Carolina Runaway Slave Ads project is not migrating over to Gateway because as we were doing this migration, we realized this was a good time to migrate that project into the larger Digital Library on American Slavery instead, which runs on a different platform, so that all those items would be searchable together. So that's something that we're in the process of working with Lee and Danny and Richard on getting this migrated into Digital Library on American Slavery. Some of our faculty research projects, like the I Wish to Say project from Cheryl Oring, are also being moved into different platforms that are actually really more appropriate than Islandora or ContentDM ever were for them. And of course, NC Docs, which has never been in ContentDM, is also not going to be in Gateway, though who knows what software it might be running on a year or so from now. Some things, though, that are coming in the near future are some additional search and download options, because I'm not 100% happy with the way all of that works right now. Some improved tools so that staff members, and this will mostly probably apply to people in SKUA, will be able to get in and edit items on the site, and some better integration of audiovisual materials, because there's some improvement that can happen there, too. But more importantly, and that gets us out of PowerPoint, what are we going to be seeing today? Well, I'm going to try to give you sort of a grand tour, and forgive me because I don't do grand tours very well, so I'll do what I can and stop me or ask for explanations if I move too fast for you or move in some weird direction. We're going to see kind of the site layout, some search strategies, a little information about downloads with the caveat that that's going to get better soon. And I will also be answering your questions and requests, though probably not musical requests. Though we'll see what we can do with that too. So let's go. The address of this website is gateway.uncg.edu, which was something I didn't think we were going to be able to score. And when ITS said that was available, we said, yay. So we went and grabbed it really quickly. So I think we're starting out with a little more user-friendly URL too, which is always a good thing. Okay, is everybody seeing the website now? I'm gonna hope that's a yes. Excellent. Okay. Oh, some basics looking at the website. Things you're gonna see on every page, obviously, are the header, search box. So the search box will change a little bit as you move to interior pages. I'll show you that in a minute. This navigation across the top will be on every page. And this does scale down so that it becomes a pull-down menu on mobile devices so that it's still accessible to people who are looking on phones, tablets, etc. The next section is going to be kind of our featured stuff, which will basically be newer items that we've just added. Right now, they're not the newest items. They're sort of the items that we're showing as new items on the old site. So I will probably be editing this very shortly. But this is kind of the new and featured section. And below that, you get to the main meat of the front page, which is the way you access the individual items and collections. Now on the left, you see there are kind of some broad topics, which roughly correspond to the four focus areas that we have for our digital collections. So local and regional history, UNCG history, visual and performing arts, the Women Veterans Project. We also have this link to partners and collections, which you'll also see is up here. And we have this link to highlights and exhibits, which again is also up at the top. And these are some special pages we'll talk about in a few minutes. So on the right, though, a little bit different way to access things if this is kind of more your thing. You can zoom down to some specific topics, like if you wanted North Carolina and local history, schools and colleges, which by definition is mostly going to be UNCG, but some of our partners as well. Women's history, music, African-American history, LGBTQ history. And at the bottom, you can click this browse all topics and it will take you to this lovely page. This is something we're very proud of, actually. We came up with a controlled vocabulary of about 30 items that sort of encompass the broad themes that run all through our digital collections to make it a little more browsable for people. So, and you can access all of those 30 topics and see how many items there are in each one of them right here. I'm gonna go back now. You can also browse by types of items. Say you wanted to look at just photographs or just city directories, you can do that as well. So let's go to newspapers and periodicals. Look, 9,840 items, and that could be anything from newspapers to magazines to newsletters. It's pretty cool, I think. And also something else, which again takes you back to the highlights and features or to the partners and their collections and to this link down at the bottom, tips on how to use the site, which doesn't work quite yet. And I'll tell you about why on that in just a second as well, because that's going to be kind of a cool thing we'll be adding very shortly too. And yeah, city directories rock the universe. I use them in my own research all the time. So if nothing else, it makes it easier for me. And that's the important thing, right? Yeah. So again, you see the front page is kind of laid out by topics, by broad topic areas, rather than by the individual partners and repositories, because that's what most people are looking for. You know, most of our users are coming into the site saying, I want to see something about history or about women vets, not coming in saying, I want to see something that was contributed by the Bennett College Library. But we're covered on that too, because if you click up here on the partners and collections link, it will take you into this page, which shows you all the different contributors to our collections so that you can actually zoom in that way as well. And I think this is probably going to be, I'm guessing this is the way that a lot of people from SCUA particularly are going to be accessing the site, because it's basically organized just like our library. You click on UNC Greensboro, and as you see, you've got Women Veterans, University Archives, Manuscripts and Special Collections. It's sort of arranged just like our Special Collections and University Archives and the library in general. So one thing is you're clicking through these different partner sites too. At the top of the page, you will see a logo up here that shows you whose stuff you're looking at now. So right now we're looking at things that were contributed by Greensboro College. If you click on any of these items, you're going to continue along with that Greensboro College logo all the way through. And that clicks back to their front page so that you can see all the Greensboro College stuff that's in the collection. So some explanations. Now let's go into, let's look at Guilford College. When you click on the partner page like that, notice over here on the left, what you're going to see is all the collections that we have from that particular partner. They might not be digitized completely, may be only parts of the collection that are digitized. And I'll show you that in a minute. But on the right, you can also see most of our partners also have material that's hosted elsewhere, either on their own site or at the North Carolina Digital Heritage Center, et cetera. So we try to have links to all these external sites too. So if you want to see more of Guilford College's stuff, you can click on this and see Guilford College's own digital collections, or you can go to the Guilford College page at the North Carolina Digital Heritage Center. If their site is working today, there it is. So you can see all the stuff that was in answer to Patrick's question, we do not have everything that is digitized at a certain institution. No, we have there are some institutions where we pretty much have everything, and that would primarily be the Greensboro History Museum and Cone Health. We pretty much host all of their stuff, but most of the other partners have worked with Digital NC, and in fact, we have worked with Digital NC as well, so we have some of our stuff hosted there as well. But we try to make up some allowances for the fact by at least mentioning these external sites here on our site as well. So, explanations again, like I said, we don't have everything. Let's go into a Guilford College collection again. Now, if you click on one of these collection items, what you will get is some information about that specific collection. And then you click this little details box and you'll get more. For example, if there's a finding aid for that collection, there will be a link to it here. This one doesn't have one. In most cases, you will have a note here showing whether all or part of the collection has been digitized. So the idea behind all this is to try to give some context to let people know that, yeah, there's a lot of stuff that we've digitized, but there's also a lot of stuff that we haven't digitized again. But wait, yes, there's more. So that people can actually contact the archives or the museum or the library to find additional parts of that collection that might not be online for whatever reason, for copyright purposes, the fact that they just didn't want it digitized, or in some cases, the fact that, well, it was kind of boring and we didn't necessarily think it merited going to all the effort of digitizing. So that should be pretty, it should follow through pretty much on all the collections. You should be able to do that. And again, when you click inside the collection like that, and then you will see all the items that are within that collection. We're working on some navigation strategies for really big collections that'll make them a little easier to browse through more deeply. Let me show you an example of one of those. Like say the Anna Gove collection, I think is a good example there. I would search to find this, but I don't want to do that yet because I'm going to show searching later. So there's a logic to this. Okay, the Anna Maria Gove papers, for example, is a very large collection that we've digitized a lot of. So we've created this sort of special extra aid, which is kind of a collection map. And ignore this. This is an issue that we're working on right now. I have a student working on it at the moment. So it basically has it divided up by box so that you can sort of browse the collection in the same way that you would be browsing, say, the finding aid, which again, there will also be a link to in the details field. That's a little labor intensive for us to try to do it on all the collections, but we're trying to do that on most of the bigger collections where it might be helpful. So let's go back to the front page now. I'm gonna show you the search bar. Well, if I'm not really going to have to show you that. It's pretty obviously what is a search bar. And I'm showing you the navigation bar, the what are you looking for. Links at the bottom. I wanted to quickly run through those too. This is another spot where you have those the browse topics, which we saw earlier. And yes, I realize that these rollover links have a color issue, which I'm working on. We'll get that fixed. But the browse topics, which you've seen. You can also browse more detailed by item types. So, and that's all alphabetical. So correspondence being a big one, catalogs, agendas being a smaller one. Also down here though, you've also got the information on copyright and reuse. So when people want to reuse or publish our items, this tells them who they need to talk to about doing that. The offensive language and materials statement, which is actually a library-wide statement, which was approved by the Reparative Archives Working Group in SCUA. Over here on the right side, the link to the blog, the libraries, and a staff login. One of the things that is going to happen with Islandora later on is that we will set it up so that anybody who needs to access the full resolution copies of items will be able to have an account, and we'll be able to actually download the full resolution TIFF files directly out of Islandora without having to scour through DAPS, which is our dark archive storage. Again, that's mostly going to make SCUA happy, but I'll be happy to set up an account for anybody that wants to be able to do that. So, let's look at a Women Veterans Historical Project record to just sort of again, see what the collection level records look like. And this is one part we're really happy about, because when we migrated the Women Veterans Project into Content DM, we lost these kind of landing pages for the veterans. And with Gateway, we're able to go back to having those again. So if you click on the Clara Adams Ender collection, you will actually see a page about her with details, biographical details, etc. What conflict she was involved in, et cetera, what's in the full collection. And we're trying to use labels like who's responsible rather than creator, because we think it's more user-friendly to the average user, et cetera. Branch of service, subject headings, topics, what's in the full collection. And again, if any of you find anything horribly wrong with these terms, we can change them too. But again, we're trying to go with sort of more user-friendly labels for the fields. Okay, and then from that you can go into an item, but we'll do that in a second here. So I'm going to show you a little about searching first, and this will be where we break down into items too. Let's do a search for WUAG, which is UNCG's campus radio station. Now notice on the front page you don't really have any options with the search. It's just going to give you a general search across all items in the collection. It's going to match anything, whether WUAG shows up in the OCR text or in any field value, which, as you see, you get 779 values for WUAG. Notice, too, that after you do a search, you are presented with the advanced search widget over here, so that you can do an advanced search based on what you just did. If anyone finds it really necessary, we could add advanced search as a separate page too, but most places seem to be doing it this way so that you get the advanced search just as a result of a simple search. There are options though. And you can choose certain fields to search on. We can add to that list too. And if you have suggestions about fields that people might want in the advanced search, please let me know. Once you're in these search results too, you can sort your results by title or by date. You can narrow down, these are the facets. And notice again, this is everything that has the text WUAG in it. Now clearly there was not a WUAG radio station in 1870. So what this probably is some bad, since it's only one result, it's some bad OCR, which I bet is gonna be in a newspaper. Why, yes, it is. So, but you've got your facets here. And this is going to show up everything. It's going to show up all types of items. So you've got business cards, newsletters, invitations. But also it will show up if it's a full collection of items too. So what the type of item can be anything from the individual item, and will also, if the item that's showing you is a collection, it will say collections there. You can sort, you can facet. Now, let's go into an individual item here. Anyone will do. Now notice up at the top how the search bar has changed at this point. When you're actually within an item or within a collection, it narrows down so that you can search either within all collections, or it defaults to searching just within the collection you're in. That becomes actually more obvious. Let's go back into Women Bets again. And this is something that Beth Ann requested when we were working, and I think it actually added an awful lot to the site too, so that people would be able to search just within the Women Veterans Project rather than the whole site. So now you can narrow it down, or you can go back up to where you're searching all collections as well. And I'll show you a little trick here. If you just choose all collections, don't enter anything in the search box and hit search. I don't know why you'd want to do this, but you can. What it's going to do is take a long time because there's a lot of stuff and give you this sort of disturbing orange smell. But then it will show you every item in every collection. Again, I don't know why you'd necessarily want to do that, but it's always good to know that you can. So now I'm going to do a search for Cone Hospital. I have 13,008 entries there. Results. Yeah, that was the word I was looking for. Results. Now I'm going to try something else. I'm going to do Cone Hospital in quotes. That narrows us down to 1,429 items. It is best, even if you're not looking for a phrase right now, the way this collection is set up to do all your searches within quotation marks, because the default setting for the search engine behind our digital collections is an or search rather than an and search. So it's looking for all words rather, or it's looking for any words rather than all words. If you use those quotation marks though, it will force it into looking for all words. That makes sense to everybody? We're trying to get it to change that setting, but you'd think that would be a very simple setting to change. But it's not. Working on it though. Again, everything is not perfect yet, and this is a living organism. It's all always going to be growing and changing, and we're going to be finding new things to fix as we get a chance. So I'm going to go into another item here to show you some of the features of how you can look at individual items now too. Let's go to the Cone Hospital Review, which I happen to know is a bunch of newsletters. One of them from March of 1966. So let's look. If you notice, this viewer looks an awful lot like the one you'll see when you're browsing through items at the Internet Archive. That's because it's the exact same viewer that they use at the Internet Archive. They license it out to Islandora, so we're actually using that too, which is really nice because it gives you a page turner interface. So it's actually like reading a book or a magazine. We have everything set to a single page because there are some documents that have weird page sizes and it makes the two-page spread look kind of funny, but you can manually check that for each item, or you could look at thumbnails if you wanted to as well. But most people are probably going to want to go with the two-page. Then you just click on it to turn the pages. La, 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 la. You can also search within the item up here using this search box here. You want it bigger, you can go full screen. You can zoom in. You also have the option of sharing the item and getting info about the item, which is basically, again, it's metadata, which you could also see by clicking details down here. Yeah, Jenny, thank you. Yeah, I will say that ContentDM actually had a page turner function like this too that we could enable, but we didn't because it worked so horribly and was so slow and sludgy. And I was really excited that this one worked really well too when I saw it, so that we were able to finally enable it, because I wouldn't have wanted anyone to have to sit through the one that ContentDM had in it, because it was awful. Now, one other thing you can do in this view too is there's this tab up here called Pages. So if you actually just wanted to go look at each individual page of an item, you can do that as well. And then you click on that and it shows up. This is interesting if you, for example, saw, I don't know, if we were scanning an art book or something and you wanted to zoom in, this is a way that actually lets you zoom in a little more than the viewer would do. As you see, you can go in really tight. You can also, so there are all kinds of options. When you look at photos, for example, let's go back to the front page now and just find some random photographs. It defaults you into that viewer so that you can actually zoom in and zoom out on the photos. The only case where it doesn't do that, and I'm figuring out how we want to approach this going forward, is things that are originally uploaded as JPEGs. So things that are actual digital camera photos. I'll show you some from the Black Lives Matter collection because, you know, they're newer. It uses a different image viewer for that. And that is problematic for me, and I'm gonna fix it, but not this week probably. So on images that, you know, actually came out of digital cameras and started out as JPEGs, you don't have that nice little viewer, though you can click on them and see a larger version of it. I don't understand why it's set up this way, and I don't understand why it's not easier to change. So, but the time will come. All right, so back to our Cone Hospital look. I showed you the book viewer, and again, I've shown you the details. Anytime you see details, you click on that, and it's going to show you the full metadata for the item, whether it's an individual item or a collection. If it's clickable, you'll see other things that have that same term. And down at the bottom, there's part of, which shows you what collection or collections the item is part of. What's really nice about Islandora is it actually allows things to be part of multiple collections. So, and this shows you up the hierarchy, it's part of the Cone Hospital Review, which is in turn part of the Moses Cone Hospital Collection. So there's kind of a hierarchy, sort of like you would also see with the breadcrumbs. But in some cases, like when we go into our highlights and exhibits, for example, all of you, or many of you will remember a few years ago, some of our big projects like Good Medicine and Textiles, Teachers, and Troops. Let's go into Good Medicine. These items were scanned as part of other collections in most cases. So like, actually, I've got a better example. Let me go to Pride of the Community here. This is a new project we're doing, documenting LGBTQ history in Greensboro. This item is part of the Frank Benedetti collection, but now that we're in Islandora, we can actually assign it both to the Frank Benedetti, Gary Trowbridge collection, which is where it lives intellectually, but also thematically, we can apply it to the Pride of the Community collection so that you can see that it's part of this larger LGBTQ history collection as well. But that's kind of a neat thing, but one that you don't want to overdo because it could make your navigation really confusing for people after a while. So, we looked at the pages at the bottom already. So let's, as I promised, look at highlights and exhibits. I really like the image with the sailor for our new stuff, but that's just me. It was so blue. But this page has not only highlights and exhibits, but it's also got a list of some of the newest material that we have on the site. I'm going to make that more prominent and it will probably end up being somewhere else, but it's here for now. So you can see sort of the newest stuff we've added. And right now there's a lot of new stuff because we've been scanning stuff pretty constantly over the last year and a half. and not putting it online because we didn't want to put things in Content DM and then have to go back and put them in Islandora as well. So we have a lot of backlog of new stuff going up right now. So check it out. But our highlights and exhibits collection is sort of a weird little dumping ground for sort of these themed collections. Like, for example, Pride of the Community or the Black Lives Matter collection or Textiles, Teachers, and Troops, where the items might live intellectually in one physical archival collection, like the Anna Gove papers or the Chancellor McKeever or the President Charles Duncan McKeever collection. But they also belong to sort of one of these themed grant projects that, and we use this to kind of bring them together into kind of a themed exhibit or sort of a curated collection of collections, if you will, that are things that go together in one big theme. And that's what the highlights and exhibits page is all about. And I hope that wasn't too weirdly abstract. So that was one last thing. The Hamburger Square Post Collection is something we're working on right now. And that was a newspaper that's been published in Greensboro for like 40 years. It was kind of the, I'll click on it because I'm glad somebody else was excited about it because I was really excited when Stacy brought in that collection. So, these are really cool because they were a collection of newspapers that sort of documented the rebirth of downtown Greensboro in the 80s and 90s. So as you see, as Greensboro's downtown sort of came up from its death in the 70s and became more of an interesting place again in the 80s or 90s. The Hamburger Square Post was what was there sort of documenting all that. It's going to be a really neat collection and one that we're going to be pushing out on social media a lot because they donated the collection, gave us the permission to digitize them and put them online, but they don't have all the issues. So we're going to put out a call for other people who might have issues that we can borrow and digitize. And that actually leads nicely into one other thing I was going to talk about, which is our community contributing collections. We have these in our Content DM platform as well. And what these are basically are collections that we don't own, that none of the archives or repositories in the area own. It's collections that people let us borrow that we digitize and then give back, which actually allows community members to share their stuff with us so that we can share it with the public, but then they don't have to give it up if they don't want to. Or it actually allows us to scan it now and maybe they say, I'll donate this to you when I die or whatever. It's kind of a neat thing. It's what happens when we do things like our community scanning events that we did as part of Pride of the Community and the Hayes Taylor YMCA project a few years ago. It's where a lot of the well-crafted NC material went, some of the Black Lives Matter collections. And there's this really neat guy who keeps buying things and sending them over and letting us scan them. I'll show you one here. Okay. It's a Mr. Don Morrison, and he has purchased many things like yearbooks, these Sears newsletters, etc., that he actually will just let us scan and put online. So we've done the yearbooks through the North Carolina Digital Heritage Center and things like the Sears Flat Top News and the, I never know if I'm pronouncing this correctly, the Mojude Singer, whatever, which was from Mott Judson Hosiery. For those of you who drive down Spring Garden a lot, that's that big old textile mill that used to be Rolaine that they seem to be converting into a giant apartment complex now. This was the textile factory that was there for years. But these have been really great to get online. And he basically, he buys them, he sends them to me, I scan them, Kathy and Erica and Charlie scan them. And I scan them sometimes too. And then we put them online and then we give them back to him, which means he gets to keep his stuff, but we get to share it with the public as well. So that's kind of what our community collections are all about. I think that's a growing area of this, a growing area of stuff that we're going to be putting online before too long. So that was most of what I had down for the tour, but I wanted to talk about a couple little miscellaneous things as well. The first one being OCR. A lot of our collections are OCR'd. And when I say OCR, I mean optical character recognition, which means they're scanned in such a way that the scanner tries to read the text on the page and convert it into something readable and searchable. As you'll see, with mixed success, this one actually worked pretty well. Old microfilm generally doesn't work very well. Some of these have been OCR'd. Some of our collections haven't. Anything that's largely handwritten or photos, there's no need to OCR that. So we haven't. But if you run across something and you think it should be OCR'd and full text searchable, and maybe it's not, let me know, because we can go back and do that retrospectively. We kind of had to make some automated decisions as we were pulling things into the collection to begin with. But we can go back and retroactively change things like that. Downloads bother me a little bit right now because there's not one single easy way to download items right now. And this is something that I'm hoping either I'll be able to build us something, or our dev team will be able to build us something, or when we migrate to the latest version of Islandora in about a year, which will not be as big a migration as this was, that it might be a little more built in. Right now, you can pretty much download anything by right-clicking and doing Save Image As. That's going to get you a low-resolution version of it. If you need a higher-resolution version, there are ways, and we can talk about it, and if it's an issue you run into a lot, we can do it. But generally, a low-res, if you just need it for presentation or something, you can just do it this way. If you are staff within the library, I will be happy to get you set up an account so that you can download larger versions of everything. We don't necessarily want to make those available to the public, though, particularly some of the photo collections, like from the Greensboro History Museum, et cetera. They don't want to make those available high resolution because they derive some income from people licensing those photos, and they don't want people to be able to download them and print them. We also have a lot of collections that are placed as PDFs, or in some cases, after talking with Stacy about the cello collections, wrong place, they're actually up there so that you can look at them as images and also download the PDFs, because Stacy noted that what the people who are using these collections, well, some people actually are going to want to look at them and use the, you know, nice viewer and be able to zoom in on them. But other people are just going to actually want to be able to download the whole thing as a PDF. You do have the option to do that on some collections. We did not do that on all collections because it's kind of labor intensive. But if there is a collection where you think that's going to be a big deal, we can probably go back and do that retrospectively too. We did put the newspapers like the Greensboro Patriot and the Carolinian up as PDFs because we assumed people would probably be likely to want to do that. I'll show you what that looks like. So you can see that just starts out as a PDF and you can download it. One thing, if you've used the newspaper collections in the past, I think you'll find that searching in them is going to be an awful lot easier now that we're in Islandora. That was a big problem and a big weakness in ContentDM, which Islandora takes care of a lot more elegantly. So I think doing full text searching in the newspapers is going to be a lot more pleasant now. But, so I would say we've got about 15 minutes for questions, if anybody has questions.
So I have not seen any questions come up in the chat yet, but as David has said, there is plenty of time. So if you've been waiting to ask your question, please feel free to put it in the chat, or if you'd like to unmute yourself and ask, That is also totally fine.
Patrick asks if we have had any responses to Gateway, like people liking it. A couple people, I have not had nearly as much feedback as I hoped I would have when I pass it out to everybody. Again, there is that little feedback link, and it is completely anonymous. So if there are things you don't like about it, those are a lot of ways more helpful to me than things that you do like about it, because don't worry about, you know, ruining my life or hurting my feelings or anything, because, you know, I'd rather know what's wrong with it so I can fix it, or so that I can make an excuse for not being able to fix it. But so negative yet constructive feedback is always welcome too. But if you really love it, I want to know that too, obviously. Stacy asks, can Gateway handle non-Latin alphabets? A heck of a lot easier than Content DM could. The problem we've run into with non-Latin alphabets as we migrate into Islandora, and I actually have someone working on this right now, particularly on like the composer names for the cello collections, is when we migrate the data across multiple platforms. So if we pull it out of Content DM, then put it into Excel, then running that through OpenRefine, which is where we create the XML files, sometimes we'll lose that formatting there. So we have to be kind of careful of the way we do it. And we're actually working on kind of a cleanup phase for that right now. But yeah, it does deal with diacritics and potentially with non-Latin alphabets as well. In theory. Yeah, Alyssa and Callie, we'll probably be working a lot on the template, on stupid template tricks. Yeah. There are ways, you know, a lot of it, I think the test site you're working with actually has the same template that we're using here, but hadn't been customized quite as much. But thank you. I'm glad people think it looks good. One thing I hope I mentioned before too, I was really very strongly pushing us to go with something that was going to be a lot more mobile friendly than Content DM had been. One thing I like about this template, and I have to say I did not design the template myself, I just sort of edited the template myself from a existing Drupal theme, is that it basically gives you the same experience whether you're on mobile or on a desktop browser. I mean, obviously there are a couple of little tweaks. The widgets move either to the top or bottom of the page, but generally it looks pretty much the same on mobile and on desktop, and that's a thing that I'm kind of big on. I'm not sure what's going to happen when I do this, but I'm going to squeeze it up so you can see what it looks like on mobile now. I don't know how that will play with the screen sharing, so this might look awful, but let's see. How does it look?
It looks good.
Okay, so you can see where I squeezed it at least?
Yes, it's very thin.
Yeah, okay. But that's what it basically looks like on mobile devices as well. So and you can see the menu collapses into this sort of a responsive pull-down menu like this. And when you go into the individual items, everything squeezes to the point where it still works. You know, obviously some of these things are going to be smaller on a mobile device, but at least it does still work, and it's not making the image 3 centimeters wide because the rest of the page doesn't scale like Content DM did. So that was an important thing here. Christine asks, how do these collections show up in Google searches? We don't know yet. We're still pushing them out. But I have heard, looking around, that they're starting to show up better. Images should show up a lot better because ContentDM presented images in a really weird way, which made them hard to see in Google image results. Supposedly, this should be a lot better in Islandora. It's going to take several months before Google catches up, and part of that is going to happen after we get the redirects in place, which I'm working with Donnie and Brown on right now. So right now, most of the Google traffic is still going to the ContentDM site. And obviously, we won't disable that site until we have the redirects in place. So we'll be able to get a better feel for search results in Google a couple months down the road. In theory, it should be a lot better, though, because the technical term for this is that ContentDM did everything really weird. I'm sorry, that was a very high-tech term, I know, but everything in ContentDM was weird. Everything in Islandora makes a little more sense because it's, you know, it's all based on a content management system called Drupal, which some of you may have heard of, which is similar to WordPress. And then it's, you know, standard content management system, which means it's already designed to work well in most cases with search engines. The ContentDM pinata, I think that once we are back on site, that is definitely a thing, unless we can come up with a virtual pinata, which I'm sure does exist.
Yeah, that seems like it would have been a real missed opportunity over the last year if no one has come up with that yet.
Yeah. And, you know, you can just pull your mask up over your eyes so that you're
on your... Exactly. It's a different kind of double masking, I guess. Yeah. All right, last call for questions. While I give people a moment in case they're typing, I just want to say thank you so much to David for presenting on this. And thanks to all of you for joining us today. We do have another ULVLC session this week, which is the Anti-Racist Reading Group meeting with Tawana Hodge. And we will have some other ULVLC sessions coming up. So keep an eye out for that. And if you have an idea for a ULVLC session that you'd like to present, or you'd like to see presented, please let me know. I'm looking for content. So thank you all so much, and particular thanks to David. And with that, I will wish everyone a great rest of your Monday and rest of your week.
And I will say thank you all for being so patient while this was happening and we were migrating.
All right, goodbye, everyone.